and gentlemen, we are welcome to this new edition of your program. We're going to be talking about Africa, the Africa that you know, the Africa that you think you know very well. No, we are going to have the occasion through our guests, through the various actions that are taking place in Africa, make you to discover that Africa is beautiful. You shouldn't move, because we are going to have 52 minutes to talk about the beauty of your continent. Those who make it happen, they are here. Don't go anywhere. Right now, let's get into it.
Afrikultures is offered to you by Vision International Holdings, your number one logistics partner in Africa.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're welcome to this new edition of your program. We're going to be talking about Africa. We're going to be talking about culture. And we're going to talk about those who managed to live in this continent that so many people describe as dark, describe as empty, something that you can survive in. Why is it possible that someone can decide to come back to Africa after visiting the world? That is the question that our guest is going to try to give us answers and suggestions for a better way to live in your continent, that is Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a time we will take to make you there understand that Africa has it all. As you can see, we are going to have with us somebody who has been able to make it. He made it, but he is still struggling to make it better, and he has decided to be on our program to let us know how being an African cannot be an handicap. It's something that you can use to better your life. Thank you for being with us, Mr. Chenyikingsly.
It's my pleasure to be on this platform. I count it all joy and privilege to share my experience with Africans all over Africa. It's a pleasure. And you use a very good statement that is referred to as a dark continent. Actually, Africa is not a dark continent, because where there is knowledge, there is enlightenment. But now the knowledge is not being channeled towards the right aspects that we need to channel our knowledge. That's why they still keep calling Africa the dark continent. But I think, and I trust, with a lot of Africans being enlightened on how to direct their narratives, I believe Africa is going to be great once again.
So tell us, you were born here in Cameroon. How did it start? How did you get that dream of growing up and become? Because the youth today, when we witness them, they are born sad most of the time. How was it for you as a young boy?
As a young boy, I grew up with the vision of transforming things, not just seeing things the way they are, but to make things to take the form and the manner in which I want them to be. And something I grew up with is I never wanted defeat. And that is what pushed me to work very hard as a student. And I had orientation from the very base, what I'm going to do. I knew how to do something related to economics and commerce.
So tell me, where were you born? Tell us the place, we'd like to know.
I'm born in Bambili. It's normally referred to Bambili in Cameroon, Bamenda. It's usually referred to as the citadel of knowledge, where you have the first college in Cameroon, as Bambili.
Okay.
You have a university, so we usually call it the citadel of knowledge in Cameroon.
So you did all your studies there?
I did my studies there in Bambili.
So tell us, what did you read in school that really brought knowledge to you? Because you're born like an empty city, and with time, you pack things in the head. What did you read most of the time?
What I read in school was, I never really spent much of my time reading too much, but trying to understand things. Actually, the subject in school that has really impacted me is economics and commerce. In my secondary school days, I really got interested with economics when I saw the subjects like international trade, international banking. Those were subjects that I took delight in. I really wanted to know what is happening.
And what were the books behind such? We have students now who are trying to do the same topics. How do they do? What do they read?
Actually, the books I read were books that I borrowed from libraries, and I had friends that had traveled, and when they were coming back, I asked them to get me this book, finance, corporate management, international trade, international business management. Those are the kind of things that really molded my knowledge in economics.
As you can see, they are giving you the secrets. I hope you have your pens and you're having your paper, because it's important to note what our guest today is trying to ask to you. You might want to be like him tomorrow. Don't think that it's just that you stand one morning and that you become what you're seeing today. No, you have to walk, you have to read, and it's very important. What do you think of the fact that they say Africans don't read?
Africans don't read. Reading is something like a culture, and Africans used to read. But with the coming of slave trade, it made them to give away what we call reading, because slave trade had a great impact on Africans. So before slave trade, like in the days of great philosophers like Socrates and Plato, we had great libraries in Alexandria, in Egypt, where they came to study, to get knowledge. So you cannot say Africans don't read. Now, if you want to contextualize it, modern day Africa, because Africans have lost their roots, they have not gone back beyond colonization. Africans pre-colonization, as when civilization started. Africa is not actually a dark continent per se. When civilization started in Africa, it was in Egypt, and thus they were enlightened. So across over time, when colonization came, slave trade and colonization, it made Africans to lose their identity. Thus, they are looking down on themselves, and they are looking at other things, and they are looking at education as something for the white man. No, actually, education is not for the white man.
So we are going to get into a gallery for this edition. So we'll call on you to watch it and meet us just after this.
Nigeria, the most populous nation in Africa, with nearly 200 million people, a variety of spoken languages, including the third largest English-speaking population on Earth, has a long history stretching back to the oldest identified civilization in West Africa, known today as the Nok culture. They were master sculptors in a variety of materials, ranging from terracotta to bronze. The Nok were centuries ahead of their neighbors, and were smelting iron weapons by at least 550 BC, and perhaps as early as 1000 BC. This enabled the Nok to hold influence over an area northeast of the Niger River, as large as modern-day France. Although little is known about the Nok, their trade routes exporting bronze and gold reached all the way to Western Europe. Unfortunately, since the 1970s, there has been a large amount of looting of Nok sites. In the 1990s, some crews employed over 1,000 diggers each day, with Nok sculpture showing up in Europe, the US, and Japan. The Nok disappeared as mysteriously as they arrived. However, their knowledge in sophisticated metallurgy and mining techniques would be passed down to successor civilizations. The powerful Yoruba city of Ife would perfect casting techniques, creating realistic portraits of their nobles and leaders that have survived till today. The sophisticated level of realism captured in metal, not seen since the classical world, would not be matched elsewhere until the Italian Renaissance. Ife was ruled by Oni, a line of divine kings said to be descended from a god. The last prince of the Yoruba city of Ife would found the Oyo Kingdom that reached its height around 1400 and maintained long-distance trading routes, protected by the kingdom's formidable cavalry force. To the southwest, the Edo people of the Empire of Benin would also learn metallurgy techniques from the Ife, and constructed one of the most impressive feats of engineering and the largest earthenware structure ever erected, the Walls of Benin, which enclosed an area of over 2,500 square miles. In all, over 9,000 miles of walls comprise this megastructure. Combined with their formidable military, it is no wonder why the Kingdom of Benin was incredibly stable and prosperous over such a long period of time. To the north of Edo, according to legend, was a kingdom ruled over by a line of female queens, one of whom married an adventuring hero from Baghdad in modern-day Iraq. Their sons would rule over a collection of powerful city-states. Over the centuries, House of Land would unite for short periods of time. However, squabbling and intrigue was the norm. Throughout this period, they maintained amicable relations with the Mali Empire, their economic competitor to the northwest, where many Islamic clerics migrated from to join the courts of the Islamic urban elite of the Hausa kingdoms. The Igbo kingdom of Nri was ruled by a priest king, and expanded its territory through sending converts to spread their faith in surrounding cities and towns. the kingdom reached its furthest extent between 1100 and 1400. Encroached upon by the rise of Benin, and later the Atlantic slave trade, it appears to have maintained its authority well into the 16th century, and remnants of the religious hierarchy persisted until the establishment of colonial Nigeria. Jukun and Igala were two other formidable kingdoms that arose in the 14th century, and by the 16th, Igala was waging war on the Kingdom of Benin, challenging their longtime supremacy and commercial trade in the region, and with the arrival of the Portuguese, became involved in the inception of the transatlantic slave trade.
Okay, so now we are going to get into the world of the galleries. I know you have traveled, so tell us, which particular museum have you discovered while walking around?
Actually, the museum I visited was in Paris.
Paris?
Yeah, Paris. Okay. The Grand Musée de Paris. And there we have a lot of beautiful arts. We have galleries from Africa.
Now I'll ask you a simple question. How did you do to stay yourself after moving all over the place? What was the identity that you kept in your mind?
Okay. After everything, education, traveling and everything, one thing really changed my whole perception about life, which is the gospel. And it's a book that I read, Jesus Christ plus nothing equals to everything. And there I learned that it was not about skin color, genotype, place, but it was about Jesus Christ, who has embraced every mankind and given everyone equal opportunity, that there is no being, human being, that is more superior than the other. We can have different skin pigmentation, but the skin color doesn't give you superiority over
the
other.
So the black mind is not defined as low?
That's no, it is not. Those are things that have, those are things that were brought by the colonial masters.
To enslave and better control the
yes,
black
to
people.
Control.
But today the youths there will look at you and say, Mr. Chen, you would like to know, how do we do to involve ourselves with the world? What are the things that you think a young African should really put in his mind to venture?
What actually is the problem in Africa now is we have what we call identity crisis. Identity crisis is at the root of every suffering and of every crisis. We actually do not, we look down on ourselves, and thus we don't have a long-term planning, because we start asking the question, we have that dependency mindset that, okay, I need someone to come and help me, I need to travel, I need someone from abroad. No, not actually, because in reality, Africa is the only continent in the world that can that is self-sustained. It means if all the borders are closed, Africa can survive without importing anything from any other continent. But what has really happened is Africa is being challenged, because if Africa gets up to its feet, the world is really going to
change, collapse.
Yes. So certain powers are going to collapse. So we are doing everything to keep Africa abased. That's why you hear foreign aid. There's no, Africa doesn't need foreign aid. We have our educational system being controlled. People go to school to study subjects that they would never use. And even when they travel, the type of education that they get is not customized to our system. So that is why I set up International Trade Academy, in order to give a customized training for international trade, and in order to set a narrative as to international trade, because it is very vital in the manner in which economies do function. Every other aspect of an economy is being sustained by the trade.
Okay. So the idea behind taking the youths and training them is like making them to know how to evolve with the world, or?
Yeah, it's actually to open them up, to give them an open mind to see how trade actually functions and who are the actors in the international trade sector. Like you have a custom broker, you have a trade broker, you have a freight forwarder, you have someone that can do sourcing. And how do you set up a business in view of the fact that the world is a global village? because most of our businesses are just customized in a community-based setting. How do you carry out your business, carry on your business, knowing fully well that you are open up to the world? What are the measures you put in place?
Okay, so that's what, how long can that take to have a master of the issue?
How long? I have a target to impact at least 10,000 Africans to set up businesses that will go across the account.
10,000 Africans are the objectives of Mr. Chenyikingsly. Well, I'll tell you that you have the number down there at your screen. You can get to us and be amongst those. So we can say that Africa has got it all. Every time we tell you that, you have to keep focused. That's what many are distracted. Many don't understand that when you wake up in the morning, try to bring a solution to the problems around you. When you will do so, automatically you're sure that you have done something for your country, for your continent. And today we have him with us, so don't hesitate to get to us and know more about the activities. So tell us, how are you going to target those 10,000? How do they get to you, or automatically you will go towards them?
This project is in phases because now I'm in the commercial part. Very soon I'm getting into what is called a social entrepreneurship, which is going to create a platform where entrepreneurs across Africa can get information, can get resources in order to customize their products that could serve not only their countries, not only their communities, but could serve other African countries. And I also have a project to work with state government organizations on how to come up with better trade policies that will favor, that would give, a greater opportunity for everyone to thrive. Because actually, when you look at the way international trade is being done in this part of the world, sub-Saharan Africa, we mostly import finished products and we export
our raw materials.
So actually importing finished products means you import something that the locals don't participate in the production. It's something that has been finished that way. They employed people to do that. They employed banks, insurance companies, transport. But now you import it and export like timber in a raw form. No one gets to participate. So unemployment is very high and is at the root of every social ill. So we cannot talk about development in Africa without talking how to cope with unemployment. And the greatest aspect to cope with unemployment is to regularize the way trade is being done.
Okay. Regularize in which way?
In a manner that the government can give, like, encourage the importation of transformative materials at a lower cost, in order that before you export certain things, they should be transformed. When a factory is being set up, it's going to employ so many people. And things that we cannot manufacture, they can import it in a semi-finished state so that we can set up assembly factories that we can assemble that.
Okay. So now we are going to get into the world of fashion. And I think that you're going to watch this element, and after that we are going to continue our move, and he's going to tell us what he likes to wear and how he likes to wear it. So ladies and gentlemen, watch this and meet us just after that.
Oh no, 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 o
Afrikultures is offered to you by Vihds International Holdings, your number one logistics partner in Africa.
Okay, now we are getting, it's good that you talked about export, raw and all the like. Yeah. Today when we see the modeling sector in Africa, what do you have to say? Are Africans in the raw or are they at the consuming end of it?
Modeling is all about dressing.
Yes, from the start.
It's all about dressing. And I believe dressing is a form of communication. What you put on you is what is how you want people to view you. It's a message you are getting across. So to me, what I know about dressing is decent and indecent dressing and which occasion you're going to.
Do you have a particular designer you would like to talk about? Who has, you know... Who is behind all this? You know, every time we meet you, you're always good looking. So, who is behind the whole structure?
I don't really have a particular designer.
Okay, so you just have a look and you order for it and it's done. Okay, you should know that they are actors, as you said. They are there like doing the raw and also producing. And today you notice that we have even the Chinese getting into the atmosphere, you know, into the world of dressing of Africans.
Yeah.
So how do you perceive that? Do the Africans really do their best to be given the opportunity to use the raw materials? Because I really like us to go back to what you were saying. Yes, how do we do to get involved in our raw productions?
What we need is just the vision, because we have all the raw materials here. But what we are mostly interested at is people will decide to spend tens of millions to travel abroad, whereas they would have set up just a local factory. It doesn't take much to set up a factory to customize dresses. Yeah, because I've been to countries like Rwanda. They don't use second-hand dresses.
How does it do?
They have tailors. They have local tailors, and they import. So it creates a lot of employment opportunities. The tailoring industry there in Rwanda. They don't use second-hand dresses.
Okay. So how do we fight such an issue? Because when you ask, they will say that African outfit is very costly. African outfit, we don't really understand. What is the solution that you propose?
It's costly because as at now, the scale of production is small. And the larger the scale of production, the more you can reduce the costing. So if we seek to extend the scale of production, the costing will be lower. Mm-hmm.
I would like to ask you a simple question. Were you victim of racism?
Racism is actually a distraction, because to me, there is one race, the human race. Which other race? We can have different phenotype, skin pigmentation, but it doesn't mean that there is something like racism. It's just people trying to have a mistaken identity. You want to identify yourself by a color, by your skin color, no?
So, most of the time, you are seeing situations today where we have blacks calling on blacks to come together and fight the oppressor and things like that. So, we'd like to know, how did you perceive it? Did you go through it, or you never felt it the whole of your career whatsoever, or when you travel?
Actually, calling people to fight against other people is not actually... It's a distraction, because anyone I meet is an opportunity for me to learn. I have friends from Iran, I have friends from China, I have friends from India, I have friends from France. So I want to learn, I want to know, and I get into them. So it's not an opportunity for me to fight.
So it means that you go as Mr. Cheney, yes, from a particular place in Cameroon.
Yes,
you don't try to go and try to look like them or behave like them.
No.
So you think if they do like you did, it will be very difficult for us to have such situations? People
obviously
complaining of racism or whatsoever.
Obviously.
Okay.
Obviously.
So what is the attitude that you would like to give to a young Cameroonian right now to develop? Because you know, in our minds right now, with all what is happening, when you think of letting your brother, your child travel, you're always afraid of this feeling that they're giving us, anti-black feeling. So how will you advise a young person, African, who's about to leave the continent?
What I can advise is travel for a purpose. Because when you go and you start hanging around and you don't have where to go and you become a nuisance to the public, you'll be downplayed on and you have to bear the consequences. What I can advise young Africans is they should stay away from opportunity, because dependency, have an opportunity. Do long-term planning. See right into the future. Get something incubated and that you are working towards. Have goals that you want to reach. I have not yet attained. I'm a work in progress. I have things that I want to do and I've not yet done them. And I'm working towards those things.
Okay, we are happy to have this word from you where you say you should not be a nuisance. You should go for a purpose. And that is what the youths today, we have to tell them, because the feeling we have now is that some youths feel that they have to travel. They have to leave the continent because there is nothing good in the continent. So it's really good that you hear this from somebody who has taken time, gone around, and is back here. So tell us, what decided you to come back to Cameroon? To say, I'll open a company, I'll open a school, I'll work with my young African brothers. Because what we see with most of them is that they complain a lot. Those who come back, no, Africa is not easy. The people around, they are looking for a way to destroy me or whatsoever. What motivated you?
What motivated me is I like to get things done, and I trust in God, and I see people, I see things in people that I can change. When I look at someone, I see what they can become. I don't see what they are right now. So I believe I have that potential to harness the talents of people and get them, impact them with my vision. So that is what has got me going. It's not easy, yeah, because we have that African mentality, but we have to deal with it.
Tell us, what is the African mentality?
The African mentality is that of, how can I put it without being...
Putting the brother down. Not putting the progress, helping the brother, what?
The African mentality is that of engagement, disloyalty. Yeah, there is a lot of disloyalty. There is a lot of disunity. That's the African mentality, disloyalty and disunity. And opportunism.
Okay, so you would like to tell the young ones that if you see somebody who does something good, just come next to the person to learn.
Yeah, and what you're saying is they have destructive patterns of competition. Mm-hmm. There are constructive patterns of competition and destructive patterns. That when you see someone who has done something well, instead to like see how this guy has done it, now you instead want to talk low or talk down on him. So those are the destructive patterns.
And it's mostly what we see in Africa. With the African behavior. So you're out there, they're trying to tell you one thing, is that the more you think positive, the more positive things are going to happen to you. When you see your brother, wish him good, so that the good should go on him and also get to you. And the less you have the negative thoughts, then you'll make things happen. You're on Afrikultures, we have a guest today, and you see that it was good to stay tuned. And right now we are going to get into the world of movies. We are going to see how it goes. The trailer for this edition, watch it and meet us just after that.
Mommy's big boy.
This is my mom.
Pour me some water, Joe.
This is my dad. When I was six, we moved from Nigeria to America, and the transition was tough.
You're an African booty scratcher.
Real tough. But despite Will Smith's awful accent and concussion, Nigerians have been winning lately.
How?
For one, African parents are crazy.
So how was school?
What's good?
Just good. Next time it must be great. What do I always say? Harvard or nothing?
I can smell it. It's so specific.
Thank you.
Yeah. Now what's this?
Jollof rice and goat meat.
Goat meat?
Yes, goat meat.
I wonder if you have like casserole.
Yo, Ale, you gotta peep this.
What is he?
Who is Ale? Your name is Ayodeji. Say it with me, oh. Ayodeji.
I'm gonna go now.
And Lord, we'd like to thank you for this delicious food.
Amen.
And God, please bless the hands that fertilize the ground, that put the corn there for it to grow for that goat. God, please bless the hands that position every bit of seasoning.
The thing is, we try not to eat goat.
It's okay. I just spent all night preparing all of this for you, but it's no problem.
But it's never too late to try something new.
Yes. Okay. Breathe.
I want a divorce. I slept with Michael.
Ayodeji, pass me the remote. Deji, where is the remote to? Ayodeji, remote. Everybody at this table, God, bless them. Give them blessings. We will continue to succeed in this house. Bless my child, Ayodeji. When the teacher is teaching him chemistry, mathematics, engineering, he will internalize it. Internalize it.
I gotta have my report card.
What? You got all A's.
And 1B+. Trust me, that's all my parents will care about.
My parents would throw me a parade if I had grades like that.
Just give it a chance.
You got a B. A B. Oh my God. Why was I not a barren woman?
You disgust me, idiot.
It was an 89.
Ah, there goes Harvard.
Did I come to America for this? Nigeria is calling this boy. You'll be selling agege bread and butter for a living in Abeokuta.
Every day, video game.
Koma G, koma we, koma tatete. PlayStation X. PlayStation X. Ah.
I know we can be hard on you, but it's because everything we do is for you.
Yes, we have sacrificed so much to come to this country. But when the story is told, it won't be about us and what we have lost. It will be about you and what you have achieved. I know it seems like sometimes we want you to be perfect.
But it's not like that. We just want you to be... We just want you to be...
Happy?
No. Happy care. No. We want you to be... I can't lie. I want you to be perfect.
But an 89 once in a while is not so bad.
And I guess I can stop saying Harvard or nothing. I hear Stanford is a good school.
So now tell us, you are getting into the movie sector. I know the last time I was at your office, you said, I don't watch movies. So tell us, you are watching documentaries. What really will push you to watch a movie? When you see the sector today,
what will push me to watch a movie is the narrative. What is behind the story? What story do you want to tell? Because actually, when you watch a movie, there is something. Man is a product of influence, so the movies you watch do influence you. So,
tell us, what do you think a young African who would like to make it? Because we are here today to talk to those ones who want to do it. But maybe they don't have the right people around them. Maybe they have been told that they don't have the capacities. Maybe they have the impression that they don't have the right people, you know, with the resources. There are some who call us and say, Mam Tessa, I'll need some money because my family will not support me. But the next day when we have the advice, we discover that they can make it and they're happy about it. So what are the movies or what influence from TV or whatsoever should a young person who would like to make it follow?
Okay, for example, if I were to write down a movie, what I would do is I want to prop into Africa before
the colonial era?
No, before slave trade.
Okay.
And see how Africans lived before the slave trade. What was happening in Africa?
And that's very interesting because that's what our gallery for this edition was talking about. We'll push to people to discover what happened. Like, for example, here we talked about Nigeria, how the different masks came up, how they went from the Oyo people to the North, you know, Edo people, and you discovered that there was a queen from Nigeria who got married to somebody from Baghdad. And that is how there's a particular Hausa mixture there in Nigeria. So, as you said, we can have stories of that nature to make people to think and dream positively. Is that?
Yeah, is that. Because even in Nigeria, as you're saying, there are great cities in Nigeria, I think in Benin City, that housed, I think, 1,000 houses. Mm-hmm. Great cities, even in Ghana, pre-colonization, that were destroyed before the colonial masters came in. So that is, those are my focus, those are my points of interest, that if you have a narrative towards that direction, I would like to watch.
Okay, is there something that you today, we are talking not only to the man, but the expat, the youths there are seated and said he's ready to put more than 5,000 people ahead. What do you think that youth should have done before coming towards you?
What you should have done is you have to conceptualize something. What do you see? What do you want to do? What do you want to change? Because actually, entrepreneurship is something that you want to solve a particular problem. There is a particular need. And as you seek to meet a particular need, you're solving a problem and you're doing a business.
Okay.
So what need do you want to meet? What? That should be the question. What need do you want to meet?
Okay. So if they have programs, they have projects, yeah, they can come to you. But if they are still looking for a way, how do they do?
Actually, what do you mean? What do you mean by looking for a way?
Because some are seated. We have to be honest with ourselves. There are some who are seated back home, and they are told that Africa has no hope for them. So even school at a time, they don't go to school and they spend time complaining. So if that one watch, they're watching our program and decide to get towards you, is there going to be a possibility? Is it going to be, you know, what can they do? Or do they still need to go and look for a project before they get to you?
If actually you have a good project, it's going to get funding.
Okay.
If your project is not getting funding, it means it's not a good project.
Okay. But they still have hope. So, ladies and gentlemen, as you see, we are happy to have our guest today because it's somebody, when we were chanced to get to him, he always gave a particular attention to this program, to all the activities that we had. And it was very important that we share out what some people are doing for the youth that we are. We should stop thinking negatively. As I said, we are going to be having various aspects of our program. And right now, we are going to make a little surprise to our guest today. He's going to watch it and tell us how he feels about it.
Well, as we all know, Vihds International Holdings is known as in Moto State. It's our number one logistic partner. It's known for its good works, its fluency, how it gives back to customers more than how they respect. It's known for good work. Yeah, so being here has really been an amazing journey working with Vihds International Holdings. I can be an independent clearing agent. Yeah, from all the knowledge acquired from here.
When we started this ITA, since we are a logistic company, we intend to blend theory that is learned from school and practice in the field. So they actually have to know what is being done, not just the theory that they learn in school. So we are focused on creating jobs for making these youth to know how to create jobs for themselves.
We are in Vihds International Holding. It's a logistic company we are custom brokers. We are like a middleman between the clients and the Cameroon customer. So here we offer so many services, like you can see, we have a school that we train logistic students, those who want to know the job. But it's a very good job, it's a very nice fee, and it helps a lot. Not only in the fee, but outside the country also. The director, the CEO of this company, he's a great man. He's somebody full of knowledge, and he's the one imparting us with so much to make us to know why we are here. So he taught us so many things. The procedure, everything, that is how to talk to a client. This our fee needs a lot of trust in it.
Actually, Vision International Holdings is a consortium put in place to give a new look in the manner in which international trade is being conducted. And we have been in operation since 2014. And the person behind this great structure is no other person but Mr. Chenyikingsly. I myself am a product of the great works from Mr. Chenyikingsly. I started as well as an intern here, and given my utmost best, I was retained, and here I am. So he has actually done a lot for many Cameroonians. And Vision International Holdings, given our business structure nowadays, face a lot of trade restrictions, quotas, tariffs, and so on.
So, you saw the video?
Yeah.
You saw the video. When you see the reactions, as the people spoke in the video about you, do you feel that you're on the right path, or that you have achieved it, or it makes you to have more pressure for the future?
Actually, everything I do it with rest and assurance, because I believe in what I'm doing. And in everything that I do, that you seek to embark on, you should be aware that there should be challenges. If you've not seen the challenges, it means you are not set for what you want to do.
Objectives?
Yeah. Not objectives. In anything endeavor you want to embark on, if you've not identified the challenges in that endeavor, it means you are not set to undertake that endeavor. Because every endeavor has a challenge. And I'm aware of, and I am encouraged to see that I am imparting youths, and a lot of them are passing through me, and I've given good remarks that gladdens my heart, but it doesn't stop me there from achieving what I intend and I desire to see so many young Africans become.
So how do you see Africa maybe in 2 years, 3 years? It's short. I don't want to say 10 years.
2-3 years.
Yeah. We know we have the coronavirus which has passed. How has it impacted you? Do you think that it slowed down things, or?
Actually, the corona has come with its own challenges, and it has brought its own opportunities. The sector in which I'm involved is that of clearing, mostly now transportation logistics. So irrespective of what happens, goods are going to move from one country to the other. But now, to me, it's advantageous because I've built trust. And those that can travel can now trust me. And I handle more activities than before, so it's to me it's an opportunity.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in 2 years, 3 years, we cannot leave that question.
In 2 years, 3 years.
You have more youths coming to celebrate you. You have Africa different from now. The youths, what do you see?
Actually, 2 years, 3 years, nothing great will really change, because change takes time. Because to impart knowledge, it takes time to get into those people. So what I'm looking at is the next 5 years, 10 years, not just 2 years. Because in the next 2 years, there will be changes, but not too significant.
5 years.
I say in 5 years, when we can have Chartered Institute of African Custom Brokers. When we can have Chartered Institute of Trade Brokers in Africa. When we can have database where information could easily be accessed in order to trade among African nations.
When I'm hearing you, I have the feeling already that you're behind some projects and that you're pushing. So can you tell us about some?
I'm still working on them. So
I'll just tell you that it's somebody who is always calm. And when you look at him, you understand that he's thinking. And that's the attitude that we really wish to see on most faces. We like to see the youth really busy thinking about their future and not just having, you know, today with internet. What can you say about internet? Seriously.
Internet is a great tool for development. It's a great tool to study. It's a great tool to get a lot of access, open up to the world, like the email, websites, to have a lot of access to information. So everyone has the opportunity to go, even without going to school, there are a lot of things that you can learn from the internet. But nonetheless, it's also a great source of distraction because a lot of people, there are a lot of funny things that do occur, that do happen over the internet. So nonetheless, it's very important.
Is there something you like to tell the youths that maybe I didn't get to bring it out of you? What would you like to tell the youth? Maybe there's something you would like to tell the youth, just like advice or, you know, how they should do to make things happen.
What I want to tell each and every young African is that there is hope. There is hope in Africa. Africa is being challenged, but we have great hope for the future. It is not a dark continent per se. We have access to information. Because in Europe, when they say the age of enlightenment, it was when they discovered industrialization. Might be Africa is still called a dark continent because industrialization has not yet reached a particular level. So what I want to encourage each and everyone is get into something that can, a problem-solving studies. That is what is really important. Study what you can actually apply and you can create value with what you study. I think that's the great thing. And you should be confident with your identity, because the only one that has given us an identity is God himself in the person of Jesus Christ. And he has accepted each and every one of us, irrespective of the continent that you come from, Africa, America, Asia. There is no superior continent. Those are just narratives that people are trying to bring into us. And I want to advise young Africans to get rid of the Eurocentric worldview that anyone that is coming from Europe or abroad is more superior, or anything that is coming from Europe or abroad you just embrace without reflecting on those things. So there is hope, great hope for the future.
And I think that our young viewers, they have seen the school. How do they get into your school?
They can just get to the counter. It's a school that is open for everyone, irrespective of your educational background, your level of education. You just need to have that desire to want to learn and to want to receive knowledge that would serve as an actor in international logistics.
Okay, so you have the word from him. The school is open to everybody. Don't watch it and say that, oh, private people or what, you know, you have to know him in particular. No. You take time, you get his contact, and you come to them, and they are going to make your life have a change. You shouldn't stay home. And that's the aim of our program, make you to understand that you can change your values. You can decide to change your principles so that you adjust to the world and make it. It's not by running from Africa that you will make things happen. No. We saw with our guest today that he was here. He left from... When did you leave Africa, for example? Was it for studies?
It was not for too long, just for 3 months, 2009.
Uh-huh. So he left in 2009, he's back, he has opened a whole company, and he has already managed to change the lives of so many. You saw them, and you can understand that everything is possible. Keep a positive mind. Think about a positive world. Everything would happen. I'm Tessa Vihds. It's your program. You have the contact. You can get to us to have more about how you can make things happen. So stay tuned for another edition. Take care. Bye-bye.
Afrikultures is offered to you by Vihds International Holdings, your number one logistics partner in Africa.
My telephone they ring, make I answer my phone call. But you know they go banso, then say they don't block book. Like them on inside the team, man no fee height. I don't need for talk, you go know. Language so sweet, easy and unique. Everywhere we go, we united. Everybody feeling delighted. Each time I talk in my dialect, I did make them feel so excited. Anytime they feeling rejected. Now so, everybody feeling me like I'm rolling on the beat like that. Bounce up boy, back in the day, we did you make the kiwi with mini mean? Who no be no samba? Si swaga for Sala and December. Anuba, mami hala for kona, Jakarta for Paki for disaster. One so ave yo, you look it sang. Jum sang ave yo, you funky fa. I love it, now we really kifa. Ban, you sorry, you basang. One saw, may yo, you drink a sang. Zoom sang, I may yo, you funky fa. I love it, now we're licky fa. You ban, you sorry, you basang.
Zoom jere, can't in the